start with the your introduction, but I am expecting this from Miss Sajun.
So, ma'am, I want to see you
Oh,
on the
you want to?
website.
Okay. Right, ma'am, one
I
sec.
no nobody is on the screen. Not Ravita, not you, not the participants. I want to see. So, where is the seminar? Where I am?
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. Please start it properly so that
Okay,
I can watch you.
ma'am. Good morning, ma'am. My name is
Good
Ekta
morning.
Sadhu, and I'm just for the technical session of the, for the technical help in this session. Okay,
Okay,
and
thank you very much.
Miss Sajan is the reporter of the session. I'm not able to get in why she hasn't started yet.
Okay.
Okay, so ma'am, I just request you to please start the session as you are the chairperson, and this
Okay.
and Dr. Gurinder Kaur, she is from Punjabi University, Patiala. And this is
Punjabi.
session number 4. And Dr. Ravita, she is also from Punjabi University, Patiala, and she is the co-chairperson in this session. And Ms. Sajan, she is also Punjabi University, Patiala, and she is the reporter of this session. So I ask and I request Dr. Gurinder Kaur and Dr. Ravita to please coordinate the sessions as Ms. Sajan is not properly available in this session.
Thank you very much. The theme of the seminar is Sustainable Development and Socioeconomic Concerns. Sustainable development is itself, in the simple words, it is the balanced type of development of all the resources, of natural resources, and how it is that if we are not using the natural resources in a proper way, in a balanced way, then that is affecting our economic and social life. So, in simple words, when we are developing the things, we are doing any development projects, then we should use all of the natural resources, that whether they are renewable or non-renewable, they should be used in such a way that by the present generation, that we should leave proper amount of natural resources for the future generations, so they will not be suffer from the lack of the natural resources. But our development model is in these days in such a form that we have polluted all the natural resources, such as the air, water, and so on and so. And the present day condition is so worse. We are facing corona-like diseases in these days. That's why we are not sitting in the seminar room, and we are on the in front of the cameras or the computers to conduct this seminar. Now, in this session or in through the seminar, the scholars wants to highlight the problems of the unsustainable development and how it is affecting our social and economic life. In this session, we have the 12 papers, and every participant should not spend or should not take more than 10 minutes. So I am inviting them one by one. First person or first participant is Aradha Singh Rajput, and two others, Neha Dwivedi and J.K. Gupta. Topic of their paper is Cost and Return Analysis of Greenpeace in Jabalpur Delta of Madhya Pradesh. Please, Radha Singh.
Hello,
Hello.
ma'am. Ma'am, here it's Neha Divedi. Actually, Aradhana is not available today.
Okay. Start.
Ma'am, I have not prepared her actually, so she's not able to present her presentation.
Nobody. J.K. Gupta.
No, ma'am. He's okay, also not.
So I should move to the next.
Yes, ma'am.
Is the local dairy supply chain profitable analysis in. Amit Thakur.
Thank you for the opportunity. And am I audible, ma'am?
Yeah, you are audible. So don't take more than 10 minutes because we are already late. And so
my presentation is on screen, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you.
Is it full screen, ma'am?
I do it.
Okay, thank you. Here, myself, Amit Thakur, and I thank SOID for this opportunity. And my paper is on local dairy supply chains. Reduced numbers are called as local supply chains or short food supply chains. So these short food supply chains, they establish a direct link between the producer and consumers, which reduce the gap between them, and like direct marketing cases we see in our daily scenarios. So I will introduce about Indian dairy sectors. We all know that our dairy sector is dominated by the presence of small milk holders. We can see that a small milk holder comes under informal milk sector, which consists of around 77% share of milk handling through these local milk suppliers. And the informal milk sector is localized one, and that it supplies fresh milk to the households. So what objectives we have taken for this dairy sector profitability analysis? So we have taken the study in the Haryana state. So we taken the first objective to study the local milk supply chains in the informal sector, that what kind of supply chains are existing in the milk scenario. And then we analyze their profitability of their different dairy products they are producing in the region and assessing their economic viability of these units and their whole supply chain. So the methodology we have used was a multiple case study of research. We have taken 10 units and then tabular calculation like gross cost, gross returns we have taken, net returns and producer share we have taken this study. So I will start with my results and discussion for this study. So how we have classified these supply chains. So to classify the short food supply chain one from another, we have taken four particulars like interaction type. So one kind of supply chain whose interaction is face to face, we call that means there are reduced number of intermediaries, zero intermediaries, we have classified them as the number one supply chain. And in another supply chain where there exists some spatial proximity, means there exist middlemen, vendors for supplying that milk in the same area. So we have classified this supply chain into two zones, one and two. So the number of stages in our supply chain one was three, and in another we have five. Like in one we have producers, then processing and then consumption. Another one, we have producer, then supplying it to the local areas, collection centers, then it is going further and further. And also the distance traveled is also one of the major way to classify our supply chains into the short food supply chain. So if distance is around lesser than 30 kilometers, we consider it in supply chain one, and if it is more than 30 kilometers, we consider it in supply chain two, for keeping the quality parameter in concern and locality. So this is our diagrammatic representation of my supply chain. So we can see that in supply chain one, we have producer, milk processing unit, and our consumers. So three stages, and in another side, we have producers, then collecting that milk, then processing, then retailers, and then it going to the consumer. So if we look at our result sides, what has been the profitability of our liquid milk in these supply chains? So we can see that in case of first supply chain, we have producers who are producing their own milk and then they are processing that and then they are selling it. Means they are cooling and doing all the other activities of processing, cooling, heating, then storage, and then selling it to the final consumer. So in other case, we can see that there are differences of the cost of raw milk, because in a supply chain one, the producer is the owner of the whole dairy and he is supplying it to the consumers. And in another case, one is procuring from others, then he is doing other activities, and then it goes further to the consumer. So we can say that profits in the case of supply chain one was rupees 9.77 per liter, whether in the case of supply chain 2, it was 3.64. But we can see that when we adjust these prices for the same, for example, we adjust supply chain 1 to the 4.5, then the adjusted milk price profits were also higher in case of supply chain 1, which shows that supply chain with lesser number of intermediaries are more profitable and more in case of sustainable. And we also see the producer share is more in the case of supply chain 1.
Because that is the first-hand supply.
Yes, ma'am. First-hand supply. And even intermediaries are not there, so the whole...
So that's why there is first-hand. Okay.
Then for the products, like processing units are there, so they will prepare the product. So we have seen that the supply chain one is having a short advantage here, that they are having consumer direct into their shops. So they charge a bit more because they have production control, they have processing control. So they have a consumer which pay them for the quality product, and also that they have a direct link with consumers. In other case, you have to go through the normal route, like you have to process somewhere else, you have to sell it to the retailer, then the prices and producer shares are lesser in case of our supply chain too. Then if we come to the economic viability and financial ratios, so we can see that net returns were found in case of higher in case of supply chain one than our supply chain two when we take similar capacities of the units. And also the current ratio means liquidity is more in case of supply chain one, because they do not have to keep their payments that they will pay later. They have direct with consumer relation with consumer, so they are getting their payments, and also their returns on investments are on the higher side. So to conclude this, we can say that when the supply chains are having lesser number of intermediaries, the profits get higher, means profits are more in our analysis. And also when we cover the lesser areas, so we have that local area reach, that we can sell the our products in local area and which are fresh, and we are getting the prices for the premium prices for our fresh products. So attributes for the profits may we have discovered the freshness quality maintained throughout the supply chain has been the major findings in this study. And also the financial analysis shows us that the shorter food supply chains are profitable, viable, and then they can sustain in the long. With this, I close my presentation. Thank you.
any participant want to ask some question? Hello? Any participant who want to ask some question? Thank you, Amit. You have highlighted a very important issue. And according to you, which chain is better? Which chain is, supply chain is better? First or second?
If you go by locality wise, means you want to have more sustainable things, then supply chain one is better one. But
for the producer, which chain is better, first one or second one?
For the producer, first chain is better, but there is a constraint, that capacity is a constraint. If you will enlarge your means operations, for example, you are procuring 500 liter to 1000 liter per daily, then one producer can handle that. But when it goes beyond 1500 liter or 2000 liter, then it get difficult, and you need to enter to the supply chain too.
And which chain is better for the consumer?
If you're dealing in local area, supply chain one is better idea.
For the consumers, which chain is better? One or two? Hello? Okay. Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
For the consumer, which chain is better?
Sorry, ma'am, you are not audible. I'm not getting you this right now. Hello?
Which chain is better for the consumer? Okay, thank you very much.
Sorry, ma'am. No, I can hear you. If you have a question, you can ask right now.
I am saying that which chain is better for the consumer? First one or second one?
There are two ways to look into this. If you look from if you are price conscious consumer, so you will obviously go for the shorter price, means lesser price, like 46 rupees. But there is a more consciousness about consumers are more conscious about price, premium price or good product. Means they are paying for, in case of milk, you know that it ranges from 50 rupees per liter to 70 to 80 in various areas. So it depends what do you need. If you are price conscious, you will go to the second chain. If you are quality conscious, you will go to the first chain, where you know who is your producer and you are directly engaged with him.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you. You have highlighted a very important issue. Okay, thank you very much. Okay. Next one is and Vijay Kumar. P.K. Awasthi and Yogesh Tiwari, an economic analysis of cluster bean production in Bikaner district of Rajasthan. Is he available? Hello? Hello, next one.
Yes, ma'am, you are audible. Please speak up.
Ma'am, please, next one. And Vijay Kumar Balodia. The topic of his seminar, an economic analysis of cluster bean production in Bikaner district of Rajasthan. There are three authors. Who is presenting the paper? Who is available? Hello? Next is the extent of crop diversification in Haryana by J.K. Bhatia. Now I invite J.K. Bhatia. Dilip Kumar, D.P. Malik, J.C. Karwasra. Nobody is available? Hello?
Hello. Ma'am. Excuse me, ma'am. I request all the participants who are here to present their papers to write their paper number in the chat box so that ma'am can identify them and ask them, call them one by one. Please write your paper number or manuscript number in the chat box. I think, ma'am, this will help you.
Nobody is answering me, so I will invite the another one, Lovepreet Singh.
Present, ma'am.
Okay. So please present your paper.
Ma'am, I want to share my screen. Is it visible?
Yes. Yeah, it is visible.
Okay. Very good morning to our chairperson, Dr. Gurinder Kaur, and co-chairperson, Dr. Ravita, and all the delegate present here. Myself, Lopi Singh, pursuing PhD in Agriculture Economics from PAU Ludhiana. The title of presentation is Sustainability in Agriculture System, a case study of Punjab. Well, everyone is aware about the Punjab. Punjab is the leading agriculture state of India with around 4.13 million hectare of net zone area out of total 5.03 million hectare total geographical area. And the contribution of the Punjab to the total grain production of the country and thereby to the food security of India is quite significant. After the green revolution, with the introduction of the improved variety of seeds and chemical fertilizer, the progress reflected in the growth of the farm output. The impressive agriculture growth is exemplified by the increase in the state food production from 2 million tons to 29 million tons during the year 1950-51 to 2011-12. The success story of wheat and rice was amazingly spine-shivering and become the dominant crop of Punjab, covering almost 80% of the total crop area. The rice wheat monoculture leads to the deterioration of the natural resources, and the margin of the profitability, which is considered as the main spur of the development, is also getting destroyed. In view of the above, the challenge in the future development of agriculture in the state would be to increase the sustainability and profitability of agriculture. Before starting the explanation part, it is important to explain the term sustainability. According to United Nations Environment Programme, it is a state whereby the needs of the present and local population can be met without compromising the ability of future generation to meet their needs, thus capturing two fundamental issues. Further, agriculture sustainability, it is ability to produce food and other farm products to satisfy unlimited needs of human, as well as having sustainable impact on environment. As Dr. Birinder Kaur beautifully explained that the sustainability is all about the balanced growth. The present study is taken to examine the sustainability of agriculture system in Punjab. The study is based on the scanty data collected from the various authentic sources like Statistics of State of India, Punjab, and various published reports related to sustainability. The study period is 1970-71 to 2016-17. Study attempts to examine the pattern of the uses of various resources like land use pattern, cropping pattern, productivity, irrigated area, water, and fertilizer consumption. And with the help of all these resources, it is attempted to explain the sustainability in the agriculture system. First of all, land use pattern in Punjab. There is a gradual shift in the land use pattern in the Punjab from 1970-71 to 2016-17. If you look at the forest, there is an increase in the area under the forest from 1970-71 to 2016-17. It is due to increase in the topography in the Kandi zone of the Punjab. On the other hand, barren and uncultivated land and cultural waste is also decreased. It is due to the increase in the area under the agriculture sector. On the other hand, land put to the non-agriculture use, which is increased due to increase in the industrial area and the urban center. And the more important is the net area zone, which is increased from 40,000 to 413,000 hectare. And if we observe that the major change, which is observed in the total crop area, which is the more than once and the net area zone. A cropping pattern in Punjab, definitely after the Green Revolution, cropping pattern in the Punjab is changed, and it changes toward the crop specialization. For example, in the Kharif season, crop specialization is increased in the rice, and similarly in the Rabi season, it increased in the wheat crop. And the table shows the percentage of the gross cropped area, and similarly, it is shown in the rice. The contribution of the rice is increased from 1980-81 to 2016-17. The area under rice is increased at the cost of bajra, maize, and sugarcane. And similarly, the area under wheat is also increasing, which is increased at the cost of gram and barley. So it is clearly from this table that the wheat and paddy is dominated crop in the Punjab. Productivity of the major crop in Punjab, definitely due to the introduction of various high-yielding variety seeds and chemical fertilizer, the productivity of the major seed is increasing. Productivity is nothing but output per unit of input. Productivity of the major crop is changing from the study period. It is but here the main concern is about the sustainability. Productivity is increased, but the more pressure is put on the land. The irrigated area in Punjab, initially there are observed more changes in the irrigated irrigation system in the Punjab, because Punjab is suffering from many problems like drought. There is a drought and all that, but nowadays 99.9% of the gross crop area is the irrigated. But the point here is to be noted that 71% is the area is irrigated with the tube well, which is leads to the declining in the groundwater level, which is again the concern of the sustainability. Groundwater level, the declining groundwater level is different across the different zone of the Punjab, northern zone, central zone, and the southwest zone. It is highest in the central zone. It is 5072 centimeters decreasing. It is due to because the central zone is recognized as the maize, wheat and paddy zone. And the declining of the water level is also depending on the rainfall. For example, if we're looking at the 2009-10, in case of northern zone, from 2009-10 to 2010-11, there's increase in the rainfall from 582 to 1008. Due to this increase in the rainfall, there is a change in the water level. Fertilizer consumption in the Punjab, as I already previously explained, that fertilizer consumption in the Punjab is increased after the Green Revolution. Nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium consumption in the agriculture is increasing. It is increased from 213,000 tons to 1917 in 2016 and 17, which leads to the decrease in the micronutrients, zinc, iron in the soil, and decrease the quality of the soil of the Punjab field. If I sum up my presentation here, it is concluded that even it is considered that the wheat and paddy is ensuring us the food security, but it leads to the declining in the water table due to increase in pluvial. It leads to the more pressure on the land due to increase in productivity and due to environment pollution. It also leads to environment pollution. So many strategies are being explained by the so many authors. So I reviewed all that and explained here. First is rotating crops and embracing diversity. It is very important because rotating crops does not only improve the soil quality, but it also helps us from saving from the pest. Planting cover crops, like for example, if we using the pulses for in between the season, it also increase the profitability of the farmers and also cover the soil from the soil erosion, bridging the productivity gap. There is a productivity gap between the actual production and the observed production. So in order to bridge this productivity gap, it is important to use this modern technology, adopting agroforestry practices like using of the forest or using the trees around the field to take care of the soil erosion, applying integrated pest management, integrate livestock and crops, which is very important to ensure profitability, zero and minimum tillage. It is also adopted in Punjab with the use of happy seed and all that, but more initiative providers should do all that. Direct sowing of rice, it is also being observed in the present ongoing season of the sowing. A crop residue management is also very important to ensure environment problem. Conclusion and the policy implication. The dominance of the wheat and rice cultivation is providing food security. It is no doubt that it is providing the food security, but it arises a serious problem of declining water table and deterioration of the soil health. To overcome this problem, practice like diversity, the cropping pattern by moving to less water intensive crops should be adopted. Here I would like to introduce, for example, 60 days of moong. That should be chosen to the farmer because it days only 60 days and it not only providing the nutrient quality to the soil, but it ensure the profitability to the farmer. So with this, the next third crop should be farmer can grow in their field. To maintain the soil for sustainable productivity and profitability, the crop management measures include adoption of the crop rotation. This should help the field free from the disease and pest. No doubt, chemical fertilizer will continue to be one of the main components for meeting the increased crop nutrient need, but it harms the soil fertility and productivity in worse manner. In such a situation, the uses of the organic floors like farmyard manure, compost, and green manure had a great impact for sustaining agricultural productivity. Thank you.
Okay, any participant who wants to ask the question? Hello? Any question from the participants or the audience? Okay. I want to ask one thing that you have mentioned that there is an increase in the forest area of the in the state of Punjab.
Yes, ma'am.
From where you have got this data? From where?
Ma'am, I wrote one article that there is an increase in the forest by the government in the Gurdaspur and Patiala belt, that's Kandi zone of the area. Mm-hmm. So according to the statistical abstract of Punjab, there is...
Please see some other sources. Now see, there is a lowest area under the forest in Punjab, lowest in the in the country itself. It is only 3.54, and every day you know that for the economic development, when we are constructing the roads or constructing the bridges or this GT road or the other roads,
yes ma'am,
we are cutting down a lot of trees.
Yes, ma'am.
So
yes, ma'am.
When we are using some data from some any source, then we have to cross check a number of times. And the other side, when we are talking about the sustainability, then in our state or in our country itself, the cultivation cropping pattern is not sustainable, because we are polluting our environment, we are harming the all of the natural resources, that is what air and so on. So thank you very much for the presenting a paper which and you have suggested a number of things, but we should also look the other factors which is not which is sustainable for the state of Punjab. We should not use so much pesticides. And you are the student of the agriculture university, so suggest us something. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay. Now next is Kamlesh Kumar.
Yes, ma'am. I am present.
You are present, so please present your paper. Your the name of your the title of your paper is an estimation of total factor productivity and its determinants among peri-urban dairy farms of Odisha.
Is it visible?
Hi, this is visible.
Okay, thank you. Good morning to one and all. I am Kamlesh Kumar Acharya. I am a PhD scholar from NDRI. Today my topic is an estimation of total factor productivity and its determinants among peri-urban dairy farms of Odisha. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. So coming to the introduction fact, we know that India is the largest producer of the milk, but if we see in terms of productivity, it is very low compared to other countries in the world. And total factor productivity plays an important role for developing countries like India, where the low input use and low poor infrastructure facility is there for dairy development. So if I coming to particularly to Odisha, if we see in Odisha, dairy farming is look upon as a subsidiary dairy farming, and the dairy potential is very low in Odisha. But if we see in present conditions, there is an increase in dairy farms in the urban areas due to increase in income. And there is the change in lifestyle, and there is demand for milk in the urban area. So we have selected this peri-urban dairy farms, which is concentrated in and around the cities for the studies. And we have estimated this total factor productivity to capture the technological factor, which is helpful in increasing the productivity of these dairy farms. Thank you. So the data collection, we have collected the primary data from 120 dairy farms, and we have have done the complete enumeration, and we have divided the farms into small, medium, large farm using cumulative square root frequency. So this Odisha is purposely selected due to the very low, less potential in dairy development is there. And the highest milk producing zone of east and southeastern coastal zone have been selected. And we have, based on the availability of dairy farms, we have selected two districts, Cuttack and Khorda. And there is, seeing the demand for milk and the availability of dairy farms, we have selected two towns, Cuttack and Bhubaneswar. And we have selected 120 60 dairy farms from the each district. So coming to the methodology fact, if I say we have used like OWS production function to estimate the total factor productivity, it is due to the we have used a cross-sectional data. It is not a time series data, and this results will give a better picture. So if I see in terms of where we have regressed, the output is the function of green fodder, dye fodder concentrate, and labor and miscellaneous expenditure, and we have color, and the total factor is productivity is taken. It's the anti-log of this beta, the estimated parameter that we collected. So the total factor productivity was calculated for individual farm, and it was averaged to have the category wise what are the total factor productivity. So then we have again we selected the what are the determinants of total factor productivity. So to we have selected factors like fixed cost, and it for fixed cost we have selected it will give to capture the infrastructure in the dairy farms, and the herd size is give the what are the scale to realize the scale effect, and experience in dairy farming it will act as a proxy for knowledge level, and concentrate to productivity ratio it has captured the how the practices have been followed. So coming to the results and discussion, if I see the there is a increase in total factor productivity of small and medium and large farm. So it means that there is increase with the increase in scale of the dairy farms, the total factor productivity has been increasing. And if we see in terms of buffalo and crossbred cow, we have separately calculated total factor productivity, and it shows it is highest for crossbred cows. To give a better picture, if I see the total factor productivity is highest for large farm, that is 0.28, and in overall size it is 0.20. Although if we see if we see the total factor productivity is more than 60 farms are below the average productivity, and more than 60 farms are above the average productivity. So coming to crossbred cow, it is 0.13, and coming to buffalo, it is 0.07. So now we have also done the frequency distribution for the total factor productivity estimation. Although the large farms are showing the highest total factor productivity, if we see in terms of frequency distribution, the most of the total factor productivity has been distributed among 0.10 to 0.40, which is, if we see it, which is very less. And most of the dairy farms are considered around 0.10 to 0.30 having the total factor productivity. So coming to the determinants of the total factor productivity, we have done the regressions. So it shows that the herd size and a productivity ratio. Productivity ratio is the number of the productivity ratio is the how much quantity we fed to the animal in concentrate terms, and what is the productivity of the animal. So if we see there is a herd size category with the increase in the all the with the herd size category increasing, there is a significant effect to the total factor productivity. And also the if we goes on increasing the concentrate fed, also it's showing a good result for increasing the total factor productivity. So coming to the conclusion, if I see the total factor productivity is highest for the large farms. So there is suggestions for increasing the scale of the farm size. If we add up more number of animals, it will have a significant effect for increasing the total factor productivity. And also, so the crossbred cows are mostly showing the highest total factor productivity. So it was recommended to adopt the crossbred cow. And there is a size, herd size and productivity ratios have to be significant effect on the total factor productivity. And there is a negative coefficient of productivity ratio at the medium and large farms, so that there was a requirement for proper balanced nutrition for dairy farms. Otherwise, the productivity will eventually decline. And there is also a requirement of capacity building training program to avail the farmers of the benefit of the proper dairy scientific management practice. And there is a adopt, if we adopt the crossbred cows coupled with the better scientific dairy management practices and with the proper nutrition diets, we would able to improve the productivity at farm level. These are some of the references I've used. Thank you.
Any participant want to ask some question? Hello? Hello?
Yes, yes, ma'am.
You are the present, but I am asking the participants, those are also present over here on the phone or on the online, but they are not asking any question to you. You have suggested us, then we have to increase the dairy farms because feed the people or to increase the amount of milk for the according to the need of the people.
Yes, yes.
But already our country is having large number of livestock. We are, I think so, in terms of
ma'am. Actually, I suggested for particularly for Odisha, where the dairy development, if we see, it is very low. So farmers are not adopting the proper scientific dairy management practices in these dairy farms. For increasing productivity, they need to adopt more crossbred cows. I'm suggesting that, and they have to follow the proper balanced diet nutrition. If we see in terms of in Odisha, if you see, there is availability of green fodder is less, and there are several other constraints are there. So I'm recommending that we should increase to give them a proper nutrition and balance, which will ultimately helpful for increasing the productivity.
As I know that our country or the farmers, those are having their livestock or they are rearing this cattle population, they are also very poor. So they are unable to.
Okay.
To maintain or to get the food or feed which the these cattle or these farms are needed. So there is a problem, and we should add over here that government should give some incentives, or they should start some types of practices or training institutes, or they have to give some loans to them, so that they can promote their this type of farms. Otherwise, there is a problem.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. There is capacity building program is really required. The training programs are really
Bilkul. There is a need. Okay, thank you very much. So nice of you. You have highlighted this this issue about the dairy farming, or through you, we came to know about the situation of Odisha also, okay?
Thank you.
We are sitting far from your state. Okay, yes. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Okay, okay. Now I invite next one, okay? Neha Dwivedi, are you present over here? Neha Dwivedi.
Yes, ma'am, I'm here.
You are here. So now, your topic I am introducing, or your topic, that is the cost in return analysis of sweet corn in Chindwara district of Madhya Pradesh.
Yes,
okay,
ma'am.
Limit your time up to the 10 minutes. Okay.
Ma'am, may I share my PPT?
You should share your PPT.
Okay, ma'am.
It will be easier for you also.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, may I start?
Yes, yes, you should.
Thank you,
ma'am. Most welcome.
Respected people, charming good morning to all of you. I'm Neha Dwivedi, a PhD scholar from Department of Agriculture, Economics and Farm Management, College of Agriculture, JNKBB, Jawalpur, Madhya Pradesh. I'm very thankful to the organizing committee
for providing me this golden opportunity to present my paper on cost and return analysis of sweet corn in Chindwara district of Madhya Pradesh. Here I'm starting first introduction. We all know that maize is one of the Yes, ma'am?
I'm not, your picture is not on the screen.
Wait, ma'am, just wait, ma'am.
Okay. Hello.
Hi, ma'am.
Hi.
Yes, start, ma'am.
Okay, now.
As we all know that maize is one of the most important food crops after rice and wheat, and it is used as food and fodder both. And sweet corn is one of the variety, and it is very popular among urban population nowadays because of its nutritional value and taste and a lot of more things. So, as time is less, so coming to next slide, objective. The very objective of my topic is to work out the cost and return of sweet corn production under different size of farm in the study area, that is Chindwara block of Madhya Pradesh. Coming to the area and time of study was limited to the time period of 2017 and 18, Kharif. And the area of the study was Chindwara district of Madhya Pradesh. And coming to research methodology, I had used questionnaire, and then the simple random sampling is used. 45 farmers from small farm sizes, medium and large, was selected randomly. Further, the villages growing sweet corn was enlisted, namely Rohan Kala, Rohan Dhana, and Goraya was selected randomly for the study. And the list of all the cultivators growing sweet corn in these villages were recorded and classified into that three size of groups, small, medium, and large. And then both variable and fixed costs were worked out to estimate the cost of cultivation of sweet corn. Cost concept, the general cost concept and profitability aspect were used in that study. Coming to result and discussion. All the values are in rupees per hectare, and variable cost includes labor cost and material cost. Cost 3, cost C2 plus 10% of that cost C2, that is managerial cost, or we can say total cost. The subtotal of labor cost for small, it was highest, rupees 18,552.15 per hectare, and it was lowest for the largest farm group, that is rupees 15,484.66 per hectare, with an average for overall farm sizes of about rupees 16,908.17 per hectare. And the reason for lowest in case of large farm size was that they don't have to pay for the machinery, as they mostly own their own machinery and themselves, whenever it was not same in the case of a small farm size groups. Coming to the material cost, the highest material cost of rupees 24,688.77 was noted for large farm size group, and smallest or lowest for the smaller farm sizes, that was rupees 23,605.02 per hectare. And the difference was among the highest and lowest between small farm sizes and large farm size because of fertilizer application. As the larger farmer have more money, they can invest on fertilizer and machinery is more. But sweet corn is introduced in that area newly, so there was no need of insecticide and pesticide at that time. So we can say they had to just use the fertilizer and insecticide, pesticide more because of it was kind of basic at that phase. Coming to the fixed cost, the total variable cost was highest for small farm sizes, ₹42,157.17 per hectare, and lowest for large farm sizes, ₹40,173.43. That was the lowest, with an average of ₹41,230.21 per hectare. It was highest for small farm sizes mainly because paying more irrigation charges, as they have to pay more irrigation charges as they don't own their own sources of water like tube well or bore wells, etc. And they pay for irrigation facilities to the from larger size groups or government sources of water. And there was more interest on working capital also. Then coming to the total fixed cost was lowest for large farm sizes, ₹26,867.34 per hectare, and highest for small farm size group, and that was ₹27,740.96 per hectare, with an average of ₹27,504.42. Then coming to the cost of cultivation of sweet corn based on cost concept. Here the total cost, or we can say C3, was highest for small farm sizes, that was ₹76,887.94, and lowest for large farm size group, that was ₹73,744.84 per hectare. And on an average, the C3 cost was ₹75,607.87 per hectare. Then coming to the profitability concept, the BC ratio, or we can say input-output ratio, for a small farm size group was 1:1.93, and for medium size group, it was 1:1.94. That was quite higher than small and larger. Then coming to the larger size, the benefit cost ratio was 1:1.89. And overall, or we can say average was 1:1.92. That was quite good. So coming to the conclusion, we can say that the sweet corn cultivation in Chinwara block was profitable for the farmer, as the benefit cost ratio was quite good for all the farmers. It was a little bit higher for medium, but it was good for all small, medium and large. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, then now the paper is open for discussion. Anybody want to ask some question? Okay. Now, Neha,
yes,
I want to ask you one question.
Yes,
why it is higher for the medium farmers?
Yes,
why the cost is higher for the medium farmers than the small and the larger farmers?
Actually, ma'am, benefit cost ratio was higher for medium farmer rather than small and farm, and cost was highest for larger farmer, and for smallest the cost was lowest.
Why that is so?
Actually, the sweet corn was introduced in Chinwara block in the year 2016-17 only. They grow maize generally, but sweet corn was introduced recently in those years. And as we know that a maize gives only two cobs. Only two cobs are fruited and in that plant. And if we introduce more fertilizer, insecticide, pesticide, there is no need for that. But as in general, farmer thinks that if we can give more fertilizer, more insecticide, the crop will be better. But there are only two cobs. The crop was recently introduced in that area. So
that is there. And they are using more fertilizers. They are using more pesticides. But why the cost is less for the small farmers as compared to the...
There is a reason. Imputed family labor. For
I want to know from this, from you, I want to
I want that you should tell me the what is the reason behind it.
Yes, because they imputed family labor. Small farmers use more family labor than larger and medium farmers.
Okay, thank you very much. Very good topic. And you have chosen a very different topic from the others. Okay, thank you very much. Nice to see you. Okay.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. Now, I invite next one, CM Glowe. Are you here? Hello? CM Glowe. Are you here? Are you hearing me? Who is on the chat? Chandrasekhar. Hello? Chandrasekhar, are you here? Now, next one is Manjeet. Level patterns and distribution of income of farmers in rural Punjab and empirical analysis. Are you here?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Yes. Start it.
Okay.
Okay. Welcome, beta. Come.
Ma'am, I am unable to share PPT from my phone.
Hello, are you starting?
Yes, ma'am, yes, but I am unable to share PPT from my phone. There is some problem in phone.
Okay, then.
I can start without PPT?
Hi, you can start. You should speak out.
Okay. Good morning to all of you. The topic of my research paper is level, pattern, and distribution of income of farmers in rural Punjab and empirical analysis. As we know that the agriculture sector is the important sector of Punjab, which provides employment to 36% workers and contributes 25.59% to gross state value added at constant prices in 2017-18. Punjab state has a history of outstanding achievement in agricultural development in India during the period of Green Revolution. The Green Revolution is an ideal combination of environmental, institutional and technological factors which resulted in the transformation of agriculture and the rural economy and converted the Punjab state into greenery of India. But the benefits of the Green Revolution has mainly pocketed by the large farmers because they are capable of making heavy investments in expensive inputs due to their large land base and high saving potential. On the opposite, the small and marginal farmers are unable to earn sufficient income due to their small land holdings. Thus, they are disadvantageously placed with respect to access to technology, capital, credit, and other financial support. Thus, the income disparities among the farmers have been increased over the period of time. There are a number of studies reveals that income of the large and the medium farmers was relatively high as compared to the marginal small farms in the rural areas of Punjab. The marginal small farms earned low income both from agricultural and non-agricultural activities. The studies confirmed that large disparities in the distribution of income among the farmers. The main objective of my study is to examine the levels, pattern, and distribution of income of farmers in the rural of Punjab. More specifically, the study aims to estimate per household and per capita income, to analyze the relative share of different sources of income in total income and to check the inequalities in the distribution of income prevailing among farm households. For this purpose, Punjab state has been divided into three regions. known as the high productivity region, medium productivity region, and low productivity region on the basis of agricultural productivity. Agricultural productivity is the average of output of 10 major crops for the year 2013-14. For avoiding the geographical contiguity, Ludhiana is selected from high productivity region, SAS Nagar from medium productivity region, and Mansa from the low productivity region. The three selected districts also cover the agroclimatic zones of the state. The selected district comprised of 21 development blocks. One village from each development block was chosen for the survey by using random sampling method. As many as 10% farm households out of the total farm households are selected randomly, and the sample of 510 farm households has been taken up. Out of the total 510 households, 260 are from Ludhiana, 114 from SAS Nagar, and 132 are from Mansa district. And out of these households, 188 are macho farm households, 144 small farm households, 88 semi-rural farm households, 63 medium farm households, and 27 are large farm households. Then the results of results reveal that an average farm household earns about 4 lakh per annum in the rural areas of Punjab. There are variations in the level of income among the different farm size categories. For example, the macho farm size category earns 1 lakh 60,000, small farm category earns 2 lakh 66,000, and the average income of the semi-rural farm size category is 4 lakh 54,000. It is 8 lakh 19,000 for medium farm size category and 16 lakh 79,000 for the large farm size category. There is a positive relationship between the average household income and the farm size. The average income of the large farm size category is 9.9 times of the macho farm size category, 6.31 times of the small farm size category, 3.69 times of the semi-medium farm size category, and 2.05 times of the medium farm size category. The results further reveal that farm business income is the largest source of income among all the farm size categories, followed by milk and milk products. Farm business income contributed 74.37% to the total income for an average farm household. And this share is 64.11 for macho, 70.02 for small, 74.88% for semi-medium, 78.13% for medium, and 80.47% for the large farm size categories. Milk and milk products contributed 16.01%, and this percentage is the highest for the marginal farm size category, followed by small, semi-medium, medium, and large farm size categories. The field survey revealed that income from milk and milk products is helpful in increasing income, especially of the marginal and small farm size categories, as their income from farm business was insufficient to meet their consumption expenditure requirements. The field survey further shows that due to the low income, the marginal farm size category households compared to hire out labor in agriculture sector, which was falsely considered against their social culture norm. Then all the farm size categories are augmented their income with the non-farm activities. Then is the per capita income. As there may be differences in the average family size among all the farm size categories, then it becomes necessary to look into the levels of per capita income. The results reveal that an average farm household earns about 71,000 per capita per annum. The per capita income for the marginal farm size category is about 34,000. And it is about 48,000 for small farm size category. It is about 73,000 for semi-medium farm size category, and it is 1,19,000 for medium farm size category, and 2,07,000 for large farm size category. The level of per capita income was directly related with the farm size. The analysis of per capita income reveals that economic condition of the marginal small farm size categories is relatively poor, because these categories had relatively low per capita income as compared to the Scandinavian, medium and large farm size category. Then the distribution of per household income reveals that the bottom 10% of the household share.
Specific findings. Do not read all of the data. You should speak out the specific findings. What you have extracted from your thesis, from your paper. So tell me the main findings. You are reading the data.
The Gini coefficient, I have calculated Gini coefficient in order to examine the distribution of income, and this value is 0.4891, which showed that it is the highest skewed among the farm households. Then it is also displayed with the Lorentz curve, and the study shows the large difference between the line of equality and the Lorentz curve. Then the value of Gini coefficient is 0.4478 per capita income. The inequalities in the distribution of per household income are greater than the per capita income among all the farm size categories except the small farm size category. Study reviewed that as the farm business income of the marginal small farm size category was low as compared to the semi-medium, medium and large farm size category, then there should be effective implementation of land reforms. The distribution of land in favor of the marginal and small farm size category will increase their farm size and consequently their income. Farmers, particularly the marginal small farm size category, should be encouraged toward crop diversification for widening their income base.
Better come to the main findings.
Yes, ma'am. This is the conclusion and policy implications. And the farmers, particularly the marginal and small farms, should be encouraged toward crop diversification for widening their income base. And there is need to develop subsidiary occupations such as dairying, poultry, piggery, beekeeping, etc. And government should provide either interest-free loans or at low rate of interest for development of these occupations. The study highlights that dairying is the second important source of income, and the farmers should be persuaded to establish dairy farms of high-yielding animals, and marketing network must be developed for export of milk and milk products. The government must provide credit and subsidies to purchase accepted breeds of milk animals, and dairy animals should be taken as collateral for providing loans instead of land among these farm sizes. There is a need to provide good quality of seeds, fertilizers, inputs at subsidized rates, and the government must provide appropriate price for their crops and financial assistance in the case of failure of crops. Increasing the income of the marginal and small farm size categories will help in reduce the income inequalities. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, thank you very much, Beta. Any questions? It is open for discussion. Any question? Okay, thank you. Manjit, thank you very much, Beta.
Thank you, ma'am. Okay, ma'am.
Okay. Now, next is...
Excuse me, ma'am.
Myself,
Chandrasekhar Gulwe. I have some network issues with problem. That's why I'm not able to connect the presentation.
Speak out your name, but you were not available at the time. Now, you can start it.
No, here is a network issue problem. Can I elaborate theoretically?
No, you can present your paper. Next time. Now start it. Your topic is economic impact of sugarcane variety.
CO8602
on farmers economy in Maharashtra. Okay.
Okay. Okay. Everybody is asking about the economic impact of different crops, varieties in national level, on state level. So our Mahatma Phule Krishi Vidyapeeth Rahuri has made a renewed contribution in economic impact of crop variety. Now, we have estimated the economic impact of sugarcane variety PO886032. I have to elaborate some characteristics of this variety. This variety has a sugarcane recovery.
Please, Riaz, I think so. Your please mute your phone, Riaz.
Ji, ma'am.
Mute your phone. Glave started now.
Okay. And the resistance, this varietal character is resistance to extreme rainfall as well as deficit rainfall. This is the major gain to this variety. During 2018 in Maharashtra, there is a flood situation and all crops and all equipments are under heavy water, but this variety sustained and gives the economic surplus to the farmers in Maharashtra. So what I have to say here, that this variety has contributed lot.
Sajan, please, now we should be, we should continue our, hello, hello, hi, continue your lecture.
Okay, ma'am. So we have here, we have used a research methodology that is partial budgeting, and with the use of partial budgeting, we have carried out the economic impact. Okay, so for last 22 years, we have with the help of area under this variety, we have calculated the economic impact of CO8602 comes 1,000 crores so far. So this is the much profitable gain to the Maharashtra and also for the people living in the Maharashtra, and those who are just taking miss guidelines regarding the sugarcane crop, that is, it is taking much water and all of this. So my conclusions are, the area under sugarcane in Maharashtra state was found to be stable and consistent rather than production and productivity. It may be due to the FRPs. The net economic impact of university release CO8602 variety was 11,000 crores. The farmers in Maharashtra earn benefit of 11,000 crores from this variety during last 22 years, that is 1995-96 to 2016-16. 16 to 17. So my conclusion is that the government, maybe the state government or our central government, should provide the substantial funds for research and extension in sugarcane. That's all for my topic. All other presentation
I
is on.
Any question from any part? Is open for discussion, this paper. Okay, Gulve, I want to ask you, because I read from a number of sources, I have visited Maharashtra only one time, but I read from a number of sources or from the articles that through the introduction of this sugarcane, the water level is declining in the state of Maharashtra, and that's why they are facing the droughts. But you were suggesting that it is beneficial for the farmers. what type of study you have done? Have you gone to the fields, or you have collected the secondary data, or through that you are extracting the results?
Oh, ma'am, we have collected the secondary data from this research station, and we have visited some 4 to 5 plots of this variety in Western Maharashtra randomly.
I think so. You have to go to the field and ask the farmers about their benefits, as well as this variety, as well as the natural resources, whether that is the water, whether that is the other things. You have to, your topic is very good, but you have to consult a most. It needs in-depth study, not a superficial. It should be qualitative study, not a quantitative study. Okay. Thank you very much. Okay, it is okay, my ma'am. Suggestion okay, to you. You. Okay, thank you very
thank
much.
Thank you, ma'am. Okay.
Okay. I should proceed to the next one. Next is Riaz Hamad.
Didi. Yes, yeah. Ma'am. I am here.
You are very impatient. I think so. We should punish your topic is economic aspects of mustard cultivation in Lakhimpur.
Yes, ma'am.
Lakhimpur Kheri of Uttar Pradesh.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
I ask your Kheri to go outside.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. Can I share my screen?
Yeah, you can share your screen with me. That is nice too.
Thank you, ma'am. I am Riaz Ahmed, a PhD scholar from Narendra University of Agriculture and Technology, Kumarganj, Uttar Pradesh.
Okay.
My paper topic is economic aspect of mustard cultivation in Lakhimpur Khiri district of Uttar Pradesh. Ma'am. Next, introduction. Mustard is originated from China and spread over India. Mustard is cultivated mostly under temperate climate. It is also grown in certain tropical and subtropical regions as a cold weather crop. Rapeseed mustard is third important oilseed crop in the world.
You are also presenting your PPT over here. That is not coming on the
screen. Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
In India, it is the second most important edible oilseed after groundnut, sharing 27.8% in the India's oilseed economy. The share of oilseed is 14.1% out of the total crop area in India. The rapeseed mustard accounts for 3% of it. Objectives. To study the various aspects of cost of mustard cultivation, and second, to study the various aspects of income from mustard cultivation. Methodology. Multi-stage purposive cum random sampling technique was used for selection of district, blocks, villages, and respondents. The simple statistical analysis was done. For further analysis of mustard, the economical concept and income measures like gross income, net income, farm business income, family labor income, and farm investment income were calculated. The benefit cost ratio is used to analyze the benefit cost. Result and discussion. The availability of land on sample farm of different size of group were: the overall average size of holding 0.97 hectare in the study area, which was found to 0.54, 1.35 and 2.55 hectares on marginal, small and medium size group of sample farms respectively. On average cost A1, A2, cost B1, cost B2, cost C1, cost C2 and cost C3 came to rate 15,045
Nothing to worry. Come to the main findings.
Main findings. Size of sample farms. Ma'am, total 100 farmers selected during the study and distributed in three categories: marginal, small, and medium. Marginal 62 farmers, farmers small 28 and medium 10 farmers. Per hectare cost and income from mustard cultivation. Total cost, that is C3 in cost, higher on medium farms, medium farmers, and small and marginal. And net income was recorded on more medium farmers. So it shows the positive relationship with the farm holdings. Benefit cost ratio, input output ratio, on the basis of cost C3, marginal 1:1.34, small 1:1.31, and medium 1:1.30, and overall 1:1.33. Conclusion: Uttar Pradesh is one of the major oilseed producing state in India and accounts for about 9.93% of total oilseed production in India. It is concluded from the study that mustard cultivation is in Lakhimpur Khiri district of Uttar Pradesh is profitable, though its adverse relationship with holding size indicate that mostly marginal farmers should go for the production of oilseed because it is comparatively low cost and high profit crop than food grain crops like rice and wheat. Thank you, my friend. Thank you.
Thank you very much. It's fine.
Yes, ma'am.
Over. Okay.
Thank yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay, very much. Thank you very much. You have highlighted the economic aspects of mustard cultivation and Lakhimpur district. I think so. You should put more labor on it, and so that the results may be clear, and you can suggest some solutions for that. So thank you very much. Now
thank
I will see the next participant. Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. Anybody is left next? Next is Lavleen Kaur. Is Lavleen Kaur is present? No, Riaz, thank you very much. Go out of the screen. Off the screen. Lavleen. Lavleen. Simranjit and Randeep Kaur. Price. Spreads and marketing of potato in Punjab. Is Lavleen is present? Simranjit is present? Is Randeep is present over here? Do you want to participate? Now I'm move to the next participant. That is. Okay, Hamidullah, are you present? Hamidullah, are you present? Lavesh Garg, nobody is present over here? No, it is fine. Anybody is present? And Vijay Kumar is present. J.K. Patia from Love Bridge to everyone. Thank you, Dr. Gurinder Kaur. Welcome. I think so. Nobody is present. There are 12, there were 12 papers, but
only seven
were presented, and among them, best presentation this year, Ravita?
Yes, ma'am.
Or best paper, do hai?
हाँ जी हाँ.
Best paper, the best presentation. According to me, best presentation is done by Amit Thakur.
Yes.
Tenu theek lagi?
Haan ji, haan ji.
By Amit Thakur. Second is the jedi sigi kudi sigi
Neha Dwivedi, ma'am.
Haan, Neha Dwivedi from Chindwara, hai na?
Yes, yes.
Haan, don di changi si. First and second presentation. Paper jada siga. ਉਹ ਬੈਸਟ ਪੇਪਰ ਮੈਨੂੰ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਲੱਗਿਆ
ਕਮਲੇਸ਼ ਕੁਮਾਰ
ਉੜੀਸਾ ਵਾਲਾ
ਹਾਂਜੀ ਹਾਂਜੀ
ਹੈ ਨਾ ਉੜੀਸਾ ਵਾਲਾ
ਹਾਂਜੀ
ਸੈਕਿੰਡ ਬੈਸਟ ਹੋ ਗਿਆ ਲਵਪ੍ਰੀਤ ਜਿਹੜਾ ਉੱਥੇ ਦਾ ਸਸਟੇਨੇਬਿਲਿਟੀ ਆਫ ਐਗਰੀਕਲਚਰ ਸਿਸਟਮ ਇਨ ਕੇਸ ਸਟੱਡੀ ਆਫ ਪੰਜਾਬ
ਲਵਪ੍ਰੀਤ ਸਿੰਘ
ਹੈ ਨਾ
ਹਾਂਜੀ
ਠੀਕ ਹੈ ਬਸ ਆਪਾਂ ਇਹੀ ਦੇਣਾ ਕੁਛ ਹੋਰ ਵੀ ਦੇਣਾ
ਨਹੀਂ ਨਹੀਂ
ਮੈਮ ਹਾਂ ਉਹ ਸਾਜਨ ਦਾ ਬਾਹਰ ਵਿੱਚ ਨੂੰ ਆ ਕੇ ਖੜੀ ਹੋ ਗਈ ਮੈਂ ਕਿਹਾ ਹੁਣ ਭੈਣ ਤੂੰ ਬਸ ਕਰ
ਮੈਮ ਥੈਂਕ ਯੂ ਸੋ ਮਚ ਐਕਚੁਅਲੀ ਮੈਮ ਦੇਰ ਵਾਸ ਅ ਟੈਕਨੀਕਲ ਐਰਰ
ਅੱਛਾ ਹੁਣ ਕਿੱਥੇ ਹੁਣ ਸ਼ਕਲ ਦਿਖਾ ਦੇ ਇੱਥੇ ਰਵੀ ਤਾਂ ਕੋਲ ਹੀ ਹੈ
No, ma'am. Actually, I am here in Malot. Earlier, I was in Patiala.
Okay.
Actually, yeah. And there was some personal problem in my family, so I couldn't get on the time. So I'm really sorry for this. And
nothing to worry. Nothing to worry. Wow. But the kisi ka paper chal raha hai, siga. That's why I'm like, yeah. Tere karke sara late ho gaya session.
Actually, I'm at my sister's place right now, and there is a very serious situation over here, so that is why. But I'm really, really.
Nothing to worry. There is a lot of kuch ho jana hai. So, hun theek hai sara.
Yeah, ma'am. Hopefully, it will be.
Sara, kuch theek ho juga. Asi bhi Parmatma ko ardas kar de.
Yeah, thank you so much, ma'am.
Sara, kuch theek ho juga. So, nothing to worry, hai na?
Thank you, ma'am.
Toh, aisi ka, main udho phir aur lagya haseena toh udho bichare toh bolya janda si, bahut aukha si ho.
But ma'am, really, really thank you.
Nee, nothing to worry. Aida hunda hi rehnda, tu saade bachche ho ke piche ho janda. Sanu bhi nahi aa reha si, asi bhi bada aukha.
Ek ma'am, thodi problem ho jandi hai na, ki Zoom first time use karna, like, hum thoda thoda sikh rahe hain, technical.
अपनी कुड़ी है
नेहा द्विवेदी बेस्ट पेपर है कमलेश कुमार लवप्रीत सिंह दा सस्टेनेबिलिटी ऑफ एग्रीकल्चर सिस्टम्स
Hello, ma'am. All presentations are done. Hello. Hello. Am I audible? So I'm going to end the session. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Ma'am, all presentations are done. I think ma'am has gone.
Maybe. Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. I thanks all the participants and I am going to end the session. Thank you.